Okay. Well, welcome, everybody. Today, we have Wendy Dempier from Benefit Strategies and Candace Schaefer from Health Trust. They're going to provide information on our current health insurance plans that the town offers. And also, we're trying to implement two new programs, a health reimbursement arrangement account, health reimbursement account, and a flexible spending account. In order to make those two programs work, we need to get more employees to participate in those programs. And they're going to show you ways to use our plan offerings to save money and to be able to be more knowledgeable of what healthcare services are available and to take advantage of them for you and your families. So Wendy has an appointment this afternoon, so I'm going to have her go first and explain how health reimbursement accounts work.
All right.
Thank you, Wendy.
Thank you. All right, so to explain a health reimbursement arrangement, or an HRA, it typically, most commonly, is paired with a plan with a higher deductible. Employers can purchase a higher deductible plan at a lower cost because of the higher deductible, so they have a lower cost for you coming out of your paycheck and lower cost for the employer. But in return, the employer doesn't want to pass on that full deductible expense to you. So they set up an HRA to help pay for some of the costs that you will incur under that higher deductible plan, and that's what an HRA is. And so what my company, Benefit Strategies, does is we basically are in charge of moving the money from the employer to you, because it's all employer money that funds a health reimbursement arrangement, an HRA. So a deductible, just to make sure everyone understands the deductible, that's when a plan has services that are subject to the deductible, you have to meet that deductible before the insurance company kicks in. So the most common plan design that we'll talk about here in a minute is that an HRA is reimbursing a portion of the deductible. There's many types of plan designs for an HRA, but that is the most common plan design. So if you look on your handout, there is an example on the second page, the slide at the top, of an HRA. So this is an example of an HRA that reimburses deductible expenses only. The employee is responsible for the first half of the deductible, and then the HRA kicks in. So if they have a medical plan with a $1,000 deductible for single coverage, and then people with two-person and family have a $2,000 deductible, the employee would be responsible for the first half if they have employee-only coverage. So to that employee, it would feel like they just have a $500 deductible. Because once deductible expenses reach $500, then the HRA is going to start paying for deductible expenses after that. Same thing if you had two-person or family coverage, your medical plan has a $2,000 deductible, but under this HRA plan design, you, the employee, would only be responsible for the first $1,000 in deductible expenses, and then the HRA kicks in and reimburses the second half of the deductible. So that's just one plan design. Some plans reimburse copays, so you pay your copay at the point of service, and then we go ahead and reimburse you for the copays that you incurred. And some plans reimburse any what we call Section 213D expense, so it's any IRS-approved healthcare item, so they can be set up through an HRA as well. So that's something the town is still working on, how they're going to design their plan, but that's basically how they work. There's an employee responsibility and then an HRA responsibility for those out-of-pocket costs. The way that we get the claims if your claims are processed by Anthem, Benefit Strategies has a claims feed with Anthem, and claims come over on that claims feed on a regular basis. They come over to us on a regular basis. We have many, many clients on that claims feed. And so the bottom slide kind of shows you first the Anthem claims processing flow. So Anthem receives the medical claim from the provider's office that you've been to. This provider has submitted it to Anthem. Anthem does their whole claim confirmation and processing. They reconcile and finalize the claim, and then they issue an explanation of benefits, or EOB, to you to say this is what we did with the claim and this is your responsibility versus what the insurance paid. They also send that to the doctor's office or the hospital or whoever submitted the claim so that they know what to bill the patient for. And then they also, in addition, send that same thing to Benefit Strategies so that we can be aware that there's a claim and then see how much the HRA needs to pay from that. So it comes over to us after Anthem finishes processing the claim. They do hold their claims for 2 weeks before they send it to Benefit Strategies. So if you go to the doctor, you've got to think you're going to have a week or two time for Anthem to process the claim, a week or two of time for them to, or 2 weeks before they send it to Benefit Strategies, and then about a week for us to process the claim. But you don't have to do anything with the claims fee to get reimbursed from the HRA. Anthem is automatically sending all claims to us, all claims that would meet the parameters for your plan design, so all deductible claims or all copay claims, and we will go ahead and reimburse based on that claims fee. You wouldn't have to submit anything to us. The next page, there's a flow chart of kind of what happens at Benefit Strategies when we get the claim in. So again, we're gonna get that explanation of benefits from Anthem. And so as claims come in that first example where we had a plan design where it's a $1,000 deductible and the employee's responsible for the first half, and then the HRA picks up the second, as those claims are coming in, we're tracking them. So even though the HRA isn't paying out on the first 500, we're tracking that claim and we're saying, okay, this is applied to the employee responsibility. And then once the employee responsibility has been met, then we start sending out payments to reimburse you, okay? And the way that we reimburse you is we send payment directly to you. So I'm going to go through some frequently asked questions. I kind of geared some of these specifically to the town of Tilton situation because everything isn't finalized yet and you're not really sure how things are going to work. But these are just some general questions that we get a lot, plus I thought you might have on your mind, and then we can ask additional questions after. So in terms of who's eligible for the benefit, the town plans to offer the HRA to those who are enrolled in the ABSOS $1,000 plan through Health Trust. What's considered an eligible expense, that hasn't been determined yet, so that's still open what the HRA will reimburse. And then how you'll be reimbursed for eligible expenses, again, that claims fees coming over from Anthem. We're going to process all of the claims. We process claims every day and we make payments 3 times a week. So 3 times a week we're either doing direct deposits, if people have given us their bank account information, we'll direct deposit your reimbursement. But if you haven't, we mail a check. It's always in your name, even if the expense was for a spouse or a child, because the HRA is an employee benefit, so it goes out to the employee's name and we just mail the check to your home address. How will you know that Benefit Strategies has received a claim? So there's a couple different ways that you'll know and you'll be able to track your HRA. You'll have a secure online account through our web portal that we have at benstrat.com. We also have a mobile app, so you'll always have that. You can look at your balance, you can look at transaction history, you can see the status of every claim. You can see if it's pending, meaning that it's been processed, it's ready to pay, we're just waiting for the next paycheck date where we distribute funds. So you'll be able to see all of that online or through the mobile app. And then we have a customer service center, and you can reach them via email, phone, or chat, or text. We also send an email when a claim has been processed. You'll get an email saying we've received a claim, it's been processed, and is pending payment on this date. And we'll give you the date so you'll know the payment's coming. So that's another way. And then you can sign up for text message alerts so that you get that to your phone and you'll know a payment is about to be made. Another question that people ask is if the HRA is actually a part of, becomes a part of the plan, so in your case, the ABSOS $1,000 plan. And the answer is no, it's not a part of that medical plan. So Health Trust is over here offering the plan, and Benefit Strategies is over here with the HRA. What links them is this claims feed that Anthem has, since they process Health Trust claims. They're sending those claims to Benefit Strategies. So that's the connection. But it really is only for that claims feed of data coming over to us saying, this is a deductible claim, this is a copay claim. Anthem, when they send you that explanation of benefits and it says your responsibility is X amount of dollars, that doesn't take into account the HRA because they don't know what the HRA is for Town of Tilton. They just know that claims are coming to Benefit Strategies. So keep in mind when it says your responsibility, yes, it's your responsibility, but the HRA may be reimbursing you for a portion of that. This is a question that comes up a lot. They'll say, oh, well, reimbursing, what if I haven't paid yet? We don't care if you've paid yet or not. We just know the HRA is responsible for paying out when you reach a certain point according to your plan design, and we're going to send the payment to you, whether you've paid the doctor yet or not. So the term reimbursement sometimes gets people hung up, and that's because back in the old days, before everything was electronic, you actually had to fill out a claim form and prove that you paid, and then we would reimburse off of that. Nowadays with the claims feed, it doesn't matter if you've paid, we send you the payment if the HRA is due to pay, and then you either keep the money if you have already paid the doctor, or put it in your bank account and use that to pay the doctor once you get it. It's up to you how you want to do it. Okay, so again, when you get that EOB from Anthem, that isn't necessarily how much you're going to have to pay out of your own funds, because you will be getting, you might be getting HRA funds as well. If you talk to Anthem customer service and you say, well, I think my HRA is supposed to do something, they're not going to be able to answer any questions, because again, they don't, they're sitting over at Anthem and we're over at Benefit Strategies. Similarly, if you start asking us questions about your medical plan, we're not going to know anything other than what we need to know to process the claim. You have a deductible plan and this is your deductible, or you have copays and this is how much the copays are. Other than that, we don't know anything about your plan, so you would contact Health Trust to ask those questions. Another question we get a lot is, so is Benefit Strategies an insurance company? Am I now dealing with two insurance companies? And we're not an insurance company. We are what's called a third-party administrator, or a TPA, and basically we administer on behalf of employers tax-advantaged employee benefit plans, so health reimbursement arrangements, flexible spending accounts, health savings accounts. We do pre-tax commuter transit plans. We don't need any transit plans up here in New Hampshire, but we do a lot in Massachusetts. So basically, we are administering the plan, but it's all the employer fund. So I like to say, we get money in, and we put money out, and we keep track of why it's coming in and why it's going out. That's basically what Benefit Strategies does. We pay claims in advance, so we're going to get a claim from you that's eligible to be paid out. We're going to pay it out. Every week, we invoice our clients for what we paid out the prior week. So that's how the town's money is getting to Benefit Strategies. We are located just up down the road in Manchester, and we have about 150 employees. We have 1,900 clients. They're located all over the United States, although majority of them are here in the New England area. And we're in our 28th year. We're one of the largest TPAs actually in the country, located right here in New Hampshire, and we're independently owned and operated by a family that is still in charge of the company and takes care of the company every day. So it's a great, great place to work, as well as have your plans. We have very good customer service. You call up, you can opt into an automated system, or if you want to talk to a person, you can press zero and talk to a person at any time. And then, of course, like I said, we now have chat and text to chat and all of that, because that's how a lot of people like to communicate with us nowadays too. Any questions about the HRA in general as a benefit plan, or how you would be reimbursed? Yes.
Well, right now, what we do with the employees that are enrolled in our AB site of service plan, mm-hmm. with the it's a $1,000 deductible for a single, $2,000 for two person, and $3,000 for a family. The town contributes 25% towards that deductible. The way we've been giving that to the employees is we pay it to them monthly. We prorate, like a single would be $250.
Okay.
We prorate that and pay them, you know, on the first of the month. That's usually when we have other deductions and things like that. Do it all on the first of the month. But the problem is that the employee has to pay taxes on mm-hmm. it, income tax, and the town has to pay the matching FICA and Medicare.
Right.
So the only difference then between the way we're paying it to employees now and the way it would be paid to an employee if they have a deductible and have to access their benefit mm-hmm. through the HRA is that once that dollar amount is decided, they would just be getting the bill paid by Benefit Strategies, because the claims feed would take care of the bills to pay it.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody would have to pay any taxes.
Right. So it's the HRAs, they're under Section 132 of the IRS code. So it's taxable to the employee and to the employer. So mm-hmm. you don't have to pay payroll taxes on it, because it's considered basically a self-insured employee benefit plan, and those yeah. are not taxable. Mm-hmm. So
One of the things, I don't know if most employees know, but a lot of our expenses for the town, like our property liability insurance, our workers' comp insurance, our not our unemployment compensation, but so many of the premiums are what the first thing that your rate is calculated on is your payroll. It's all payroll, it's all based on your payroll. So the more benefits we can give that are non-taxable, that aren't shown in your gross earnings, like right now with your premium co-payments, you're paid pre-tax. That's why when you get your W-2 at the end of the year, you're going, wait a minute, I gross more money than that. Yes, you did, but you didn't have to pay taxes on it to report it for taxing purposes. So that's one of the reasons, too, why this would benefit both union and non-union, is that you're all entitled to the same benefit, and you just don't have to pay taxes.
Right.
And it can help, and the more people that participate, the more our payroll figures come down.
So how would that benefit if there's a portion of it paid, the deductible, in an HRA?
Say again.
How would that benefit? How would that work if there was a portion of it paid, a percentage of the deductible paid?
It's still non-taxable. See, right now, because we're giving the money directly to the employee.
Doesn't it go through payroll?
No,
no, it doesn't go through. It goes through what's called a Section 132 HRA plan. So it's not money coming. It's not considered payroll funds.
Right.
It's considered an employee benefit plan.
So we would just pay that directly.
We pay.
We would pay
they send us
strategies
the bill.
Mm-hmm. For that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then that way, we don't have any. We have no. We're not touching. We're not seeing any employee benefits. Nothing. It's just a
it's not going through the employee.
Right.
Role.
No.
Yeah.
And in terms of what the claims that come in, the employer has no access to the providers.
Right.
We
right.
tell them claims were incurred on this date for this dollar amount for this employee, but there's no provider information. You'll be able to see it when you log in as an employee. You can see who the provider was that submitted the claim to Anthem and came over to us, but your the employer has no access to that portal. They're not a completely separate administrative portal.
Mm-hmm. One of the concerns that we heard from employees, and I think this is why we don't have as many people taking advantage of it as we had hoped, because it saves the town money, saves the employee money, is that they're afraid that, let's say, Noelle breaks her leg, okay, and she's got to go in, see an orthopedist, and then they have to put some pins in, and she's going to need some physical therapy. Now, she doesn't have to worry about not being paid because the town offers a wonderful short-term income disability policy, so she's got that that she can live on. She's got her health insurance that's going to pay for all this. But it's like, how do you all of a sudden come up with all this money to start paying medical bills?
Right.
And by having the HRA, again, depending upon how we set it up, you don't have to come up with all that money up front. And then also, if people watch and budget and plan, I mean, you pretty much know what your medical expenses are going to be during the year. You know what medications you're taking. You know, geez, I'm going to have, I see four doctors, regular doctors for whatever's going on. That you'll know what that's going to cost. So that you can put away pre-tax in a flexible spending account, which Candace is going to describe. So it's not like you're not going to be hit with all this expense up front.
And the other thing is, with services that are subject to the deductible, you don't have to pay those at the point of service. So when you go in to that emergency room, they're not going to say, oh, you've got to pay us $900 right now. They send it through the insurance company, that whole process happens, and then you get a bill. So you don't have to worry about paying for it up front.
Right.
And then if it hits the HRA plan design, we're sending that check to you, and that's happening fairly quickly to when the doctor's getting the information from Anthem, and then their billing cycle comes up. A lot of times with Anthem, people, even with Anthem, because Anthem holds the claims for 2 weeks before they put them on the feed, but even still, a lot of times people get the check before you even get the bill from the provider, or they come within a few days of each other. So just know that you don't have to pay up front for those deductible expenses.
And it's better for employees to hear that from you than from me.
Yeah.
So, because you'd be administering the program.
Yep. We have about 750 clients with HRAs. They're very, very common. Not so much in the public sector in New Hampshire, but they're extremely common in the private sector and the public sector outside of New England. New England's the old guard insurance region of the country. We're the slowest to make changes that the rest of the country has done years ago. But they're a very, very common plan design, and it is a great way for the employer to pay less for the plan, but not put that full deductible or out-of-pocket cost back onto the employee. Instead, they're saying, okay, we're gonna share a portion of it. And then because the premium's lower, it's less coming out of your paycheck for the portion of the premium that you pay.
Right.
And then with Anthem, with the claims fee, you don't have to do anything to get reimbursed. You don't have to fill out paperwork. You don't have to think, oh, I need to submit this. Do I not submit that? It's coming over from Anthem. We know the plan design. We're tracking, and we're paying out whenever we need to pay out.
Well, right now, the town's policy is that we pay 100% of the premium.
Oh, nice.
So, the, you know, when I say now open enrollment, like, here's a deal, this is a great deal, because you're having less money taken out of your paycheck every week. So just kind of set that aside and, you know, mm-hmm. get some interest earnings on it or whatever. And but I think it's the fear of, oh my God, I'm going to be hit with all these bills and I'm not going to have the money.
Right. And when Candace talks about the FSA, if you know you're going to mm-hmm. have deductible expenses, she can talk about how that portion that the HRA is not paying, mm-hmm. how you can set money aside pre-tax and have mm-hmm. it available up front mm-hmm. Through an FSA. Pretty soon you'll have all these acronyms down.
Yeah.
It'll all make sense.
And I'll give you some real-life examples of the deductible and how it would work with the HRA and everything, too, mm-hmm. as we go along.
But the HRA,
so you, the town pays 25%. This is, and sorry, I came down late.
No, that's
I had a, something else that I needed to take care of. But so you guys pay half, your company pays half the deductible. So then this would be really 75%.
That's just an example.
That's an example of
a plan.
No, we
design.
Just pay, right now, we just pay 25%.
Okay.
So each employer tells benefit strategies what their plan design will be. The most common is that one that's in the example where an employer has a deductible mm-hmm. and they say the employees are responsible for the first half and the HRA the second half.
So the portion that you would cover under our current model would be 25%. So we'd still be responsible for the 75%. Mm-hmm.
But are you paying that out whether they had deductible expenses or not?
That is correct.
Okay.
That's why they're paying taxes on it.
Yeah. So this is going to be reimbursing for an actual expense incurred.
So, and correct me if I'm wrong, a lot of subscribers don't even reach their deductible.
Right.
So.
Yeah. You can have someone who hits their deductible in full. You can have someone who doesn't touch it at all
mm-hmm.
for many years.
Mm-hmm.
So it depends on utilization on the plan.
It
so we'll chat about that
yeah.
a little bit.
In any given year, only about 20% of the population of a plan hits a deductible. Most
mm-hmm.
people don't, or only, I've never hit a deductible. Mm-hmm. I've tried, because I want to get and hit it and then never if they paid it 100%, but I never get there.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess it means you're healthy, so really you're winning.
and this plan only applies to the site of service plan, because that's the only plan we offer that has a deductible.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Candace, talk about the rest of it.
I can stay.
I can stay until 2.
Okay.
And then I have to, as long as I'm out of here by 2, I'm fine.
Okay. How are your brains? Everybody doing okay?
Yep.
All right. So as Joyce said, my name is Candace. I'm your benefits advisor from Health Trust. So I'm going to talk about the site of service plan a little bit more in depth, explain how that plan works, how it compares to your current plan, the AB20 that I think everybody is on. There's just very few people who actually took the site of service plan. Then I created an Excel sheet that we're going to look at. It's a cost calculator, so we can play with that a little bit. Take a look at, you know, if you had this service and this service and this service, what would it cost you under the site of service plan? How does that factor in the premiums? If the town covers the entire premium for site of service, how much do you save at the very beginning? And then how much would you save based on how much you utilize the plan? So we'll go over that as well. And then once we've hopefully answered every question you have about the plan, I'm gonna talk about the Slice of Life program that I know a lot of people don't take advantage of. It is the wellness program offered through Health Trust where you can earn up to $475 every year. And if you have eligible dependents on the plan, so children, you can get up to $200 a year for them as well, for each dependent child. So we'll talk about that too. But so I'm going to go through everything inside of your folder. I'm going to focus on the things that are on the right, and then I will throw in information about the FSA as well. So that's another thing we have to talk about.
Catherine. So inside of your folder on the right-hand side, just if you're not familiar with HealthTrust, I just put some basic information in there for you. There's two things that I want to highlight. A lot of people forget that they have, especially for folks who are out on the road and who do work like you do. It's on the back. The first is the vision care discount that you guys have access to. So through both your Anthem coverage and through your Delta Dental coverage, you have access to up to a 35% discount on the purchase of frames, lenses, and contact lenses. Did anybody know they had that? No. So if you show your Anthem card or your Delta Dental card, you can get up to a 35% discount on those items. Okay? As long as it's a participating provider. The other thing I want to highlight is what we call the peace of mind coverage on the bottom. It's not something that we like to talk about. Did you want to come over here?
Yeah, I'll come in a minute.
Okay. Is the peace of mind coverage, so we don't like to talk about it, but in the event of your death, for any reason whatsoever, if you were to pass, the subscribers, the dependents that are on your plan at the time of your death would be covered for 12 months, no premiums. They don't have to pay anything. HealthTrust covers them for those 12 months. If you are to die in the line of duty, again, we don't like to talk about it, but if it does happen, we will cover your dependents indefinitely until your spouse or significant other on the plan is eligible for Medicare and your children age out, so up to the age of 26. Okay, so just one last thing that they have to worry about. So that's on this one here. All right, now the interesting stuff. So the next thing inside your folder on the right is this comparison chart. This is a current comparison of your current plan, which is the plan on the left, the AB20 plan. And the site of service plan is on the right. So what I've done is I've put them side by side for you so you can take a look and compare them line by line. I do have the cost sharing schedules. These are the longer 4-page descriptions of the plans. If you want one after, feel free to take one. But I've condensed it onto one sheet for you to make it a little easier. Okay. So I'm not gonna cover every single line on this sheet, but I'm gonna touch on the major differences between the two plans, explain the deductible a little bit, and then we can play with that calculator a little bit, okay? So the first difference that you're gonna see between these two plans, first, the similarities, I should say, are that the network is identical. So whether you are on the current Access Blue 20 plan, if you were to switch to the site of service plan, or vice versa, the networks are identical. You have access to the Access Blue New England plan, network, which covers 100% of all the primary care physicians in the state, 98% of all the specialists, and all of the hospitals in the state of New Hampshire are in our network. You also have access to providers in all of New England. Okay, so as long as they are an Access Blue provider, and the network is very extensive through all of New England, you can go ahead and see them in the network. You also have the ability to self-refer your care within the network. So that means if you don't want to work with a primary care physician and you just want to go straight to a specialist on your own, you can do that on either one of these plans, as long as the provider is in the Access Blue network. Okay. Any questions about that?
Well, some providers, though, do require a referral.
Correct. So there are some specialists who won't even give you a visit without having a referral from your PCP, your primary care provider.
Yeah.
So that is true, but in terms of the plan covering the visit, you don't need that PCP referral in place, but they may require it in order to schedule you a visit. That's the office's own personnel policy. So the first difference you're going to see with this plan is on the top, we have three types of cost sharing on this plan. And cost sharing means the plan pays something, you pay something. So it is co-payments, co-insurance, which only applies to durable medical equipment, we'll talk about that, and that deductible that we've talked about. Okay. So on the top here, you're going to notice that if you're going to a primary care physician, a PCP, your co-payment is going to be the same, $20, regardless of which plan you choose. The next line is a specialty visit. So a specialist is pretty much any doctor that ends in an IST. Neurologist, endocrinologist, cardiologist, rheumatologist, chiropractors also tend to bill as specialists. Okay. Those would be at a $40 copayment under the site of service plan. So there is a split copayment there that is a difference between the two plans. Your emergency room and urgent care copayments would remain the same. Okay, and just like it is now, if you're admitted to the hospital from the emergency room, your copayment is waived. That happens on either plan. Good time. So the next item is the standard deductible. Don't get scared by this number. It is a scary number, no, I understand. It's $1,000 per person, up to a combined max of $3,000 per family plan.
This is not something that you have to pay out of your pocket at the beginning of the year before the plan will start covering anything on the plan. It's only applicable to certain services. So as Wendy and I mentioned earlier, some people don't hit the deductible at all in a year, and others hit it every single year. It all depends on what they utilize on the plan. Okay. So as we go down through the plan, you're gonna see that the words standard deductible are in certain boxes. Those are the services that are subject to the deductible. So if you see a box and it says copayment or something else, that means it's not subject to the deductible on this plan. So just to give you some examples, and we'll talk about more, if you're having high-end radiology like MRIs, CAT scans, PET scans, things like that, those are subject to the deductible. An inpatient hospitalization is subject to the deductible under this plan, so if you're actually admitted into the hospital, okay? And the deductible is per person, up to a combined max. So if you're on a single plan, the absolute most you pay in deductible is $1,000. If you have services that are subject to the deductible that are more than $1,000, the max you pay is $1,000. The plan will cover everything else in full after that if it's a deductible expense. Okay, so I'll give you some examples. And remember that I do know that the town is looking at an HRA. So remember that while I'm talking about a $1,000 deductible, your share of that may be lower if they negotiate an HRA in. Okay. So the last type of cost sharing is the durable medical equipment. So durable medical equipment, DME, those are things like crutches, wheelchairs, CPAP sleeping machines. Oxygen is another good example. It's a medical item, medical equipment. You would pay 20% of the cost of the item, just like you do now in your Access Blue plan, but that's after a separate $100 deductible on the site of service plan. So you'd pay $100 and then 20% of the cost of the item for the rest of the year if you have ongoing durable medical equipment. Questions about that?
So on the durable medical equipment, that $100, then let's say you have three people on the plan and all three of them need crutches, then there's going to be $100 for each person one time that year.
Correct.
And then you pay 20% on the rest of it.
Yes.
That's odd.
It's just like the regular deductible works, very similar, except you have that co-insurance after that deductible.
Okay.
Correct. So I'm going to go over a couple different deductible items and a couple different services, and I'm going to give you an example of if I was on the site of service plan compared to the Access Blue plan, what would I pay out of my pocket? Okay. So as you go down, you're going to notice like inpatient services here. Currently, if you were admitted into the hospital, you would not pay anything for your inpatient hospitalization. Under the site of service plan, you would pay your $1,000 deductible. Even if you're on a family plan, if you got admitted into the hospital, you would pay up to $1,000 for your visit. We all know average 3-day stay in the hospital is over $15,000. You wouldn't pay that. Say the bill came in at $15,000. You would be responsible for $1,000 of that visit. The rest would be covered in full by the medical plan. Then if you have anything else subject to the deductible for the rest of the year, they're covered in full by the medical plan because you've already paid your deductible. So you only pay that $1,000 once if you have something subject to the deductible. Okay. Yes.
That would be once per person in your family or once per person?
Correct. Once per person in your family, so up to a combined max of three for the entire family.
Combined max of three.
Yes, okay. Combined max of three. So let me give you an example. We talked about MRIs a little bit, those being subject to the deductible. Inpatient hospitalization stays subject to the deductible. So let's say I'm on the ski slopes, I fall down, I do a number on my knee, they rush me to the emergency room, I need an MRI right away. Okay, yeah, I did this a few years ago, can you tell? So they rush me to the emergency room, they put me right into the MRI machine, it's the beginning of the year, I haven't paid any deductible yet, and my MRI costs $1,500. I pay my $1,000 share, the rest of my MRI is covered in full. Then 2 weeks later, I'm really accident prone, I bang up something else. And they put me into the hospital as an inpatient, let's just say, knock on wood. That entire inpatient stay would be covered in full because I've already met my $1,000 deductible. Same example, I'm on a family plan. Okay, I've already met my deductible, so anything else I have subject to the deductible for the rest of the calendar year is covered in full. But let's say my husband, he fell on the slopes too and he needs an MRI. he would have to pay up to his $1,000 deductible, the same for my daughter.
Okay.
But if you have, say, 8 or 9 family members, they're all on the medical plan, and all of them need something subject to the deductible, the absolute max you pay deductible is $3,000 for a family plan.
Okay.
And that doesn't factor in any HRA that you would have. Does that make sense to everybody how that works?
What's HRA?
A health reimbursement account.
Okay.
Which Wendy went over
that.
That
part
I know what that is.
We can go
good.
Through it again at the end because a couple
awesome.
People came
okay.
in.
I just didn't know that the lingo.
Oh, sorry. Health reimbursement.
So the important word there is combined.
Yes. Cumulative for a family.
Cumulative
yep.
for a family.
Yes. So if you have a single plan, deductible max is $1,000. Two person is $2,000. And family is $3,000.
Okay.
So if you have one person in your family of 8 who's super accident prone, is the only one that you know could potentially hit deductible, the most your family would pay is $1,000.
Okay.
So it's per person. Perfect.
I have a question about that though, but you're still subject to all the co-pays, which is where the out-of-pocket limit comes from, I'm assuming?
Correct.
Because these are out-of-pocket limits, so, I mean, everything's covered, but then if you have somebody who's very accident-prone and they have to go to the emergency room all the time because they're getting into skiing accidents, and every time you got to pay $100, so if you're
correct.
On the SOS plan and it's a family plan, you could be paying up to $10,000 in co-pays, which would be, like, astronomical. I mean, that would be...
Correct.
All the time, but it could happen.
Potentially. That out-of-pocket limit is there for you as a protection for you as the consumer. So if you were to have the worst possible year ever imaginable.
Not if you're on a family.
Okay.
Says 10.
Right.
But
so
that would be for if you were accident-prone and he was accident-prone and you were hospitalized and you were hospitalized, it's $5,000 for him.
It's a cumulative for the whole family.
Or $10,000 for the whole family.
Right.
So
in a 12-month calendar year, correct?
Right.
Yes,
right.
In a 12-month calendar year. So you are correct. So let's say you have that family plan and 3 or more people in your family have deductible expenses, then you would have paid up to $3,000 in deductible. Then for those other cost-sharing items, so co-payments and co-insurance, you would have to come up with $7,000 to get to that cap. If you hit it, then everything is covered in full for the remainder of the year. To put this in perspective, though, that $5,000, $10,000 number is exactly what you had last year. You probably didn't even know it. Okay, so your $5,000, $10,000 cap, exactly the same thing that you had last year. You may not even know it. Okay, but this year, what's nice is now that out-of-pocket limit includes both your medical expenses and your prescription copays, too. Before, they used to be separate. Okay, so remember, it's just a protection for you as the consumer. We have not had anyone hit that cap. Okay, you would have to have like really horrible year or have an extremely expensive piece of durable medical equipment, for example.
Okay.
They're looking at them.
All right. So the next few lines are talking about your preventive care under either plan. Your preventive care, so your routine annual physicals, your mammograms, colonoscopies, visits to your OBGYN for pap smears, those annual. Exams are covered in full with no copayment.
Okay.
Question. So it, Anthem note will know your primary care codes these procedures such that they know that it's preventative care and not to charge
correct.
You, not even a copay.
Correct.
Okay.
Yep. So it's the provider who's coding it, and when they send in the claim into Anthem, they code it with a certain medical code.
Okay.
If it's coded as preventative, you will not pay a copayment at all for that
okay.
visit.
And then another quick question that's come up for women is Anthem, now you go for your annual mammogram,
mm-hmm.
and then you get a bill from the provider because they're doing some new high-tech
mm-hmm.
procedure.
Mm-hmm.
That, I mean, you don't know. You go in, they do whatever they do. So what's up with that?
That has been fixed.
Okay.
So there was an issue with 3D mammograms.
3D. That's
3D mammograms where providers were trying to balance bill patients or telling them that they may not be covered. That has been resolved. It should not be an issue moving forward.
Okay.
Where the mammograms are being covered in full, and we have told Anthem to override any of the 3D mammograms. So your group should not see any issues with that moving forward.
Okay.
It was just an administrative issue.
Okay, and one other one, too, is on the, have we gotten to ambulances yet?
Not yet.
Okay, I'll save my
question. We will get there, though.
I'll save my question.
Okay. So quickly, just going down, we talked about your routine preventive care. One difference between these two plans is right now for frames and lenses, which you may not know, under your current plan, the Access Blue, you get up to a $40 reimbursement per year. This is separate from that discount program I told you about. So if you send in a claim form to Anthem with an itemized receipt, you'll get a $40 reimbursement back for the purchase of frames, lenses, or contact lenses. They have to be prescription. Did anybody know they had that?
Yes.
Good.
Yeah.
Awesome.
It's like 10% of what it actually costs.
I know,
yeah.
But it's nice to get at
one
least
of those
something
checks
back
to cash right now.
And it's per person on the plan. Yes.
Is it too late to do one for last year if you didn't know about it?
I think you have 60 days, but I don't quote me on that.
Okay.
There is a number on the front of your packets. That's our Enrollee Services call center.
Okay.
If you were to call that number, you can ask them that question and they'd be able to answer that for you. Okay. On the site of service plan, that reimbursement's not available. Okay, so just a difference between those two. Now I'm gonna have you star one of these items real quick where it says outpatient surgery laboratory tests. Can you do a big star right on that one there for me? Where it says outpatient surgery laboratory x-rays and ultrasounds. Just put a big huge star on that one. We're gonna go back to that. Okay, and I'll tell you why. Maternity care, I just like to highlight this. Under your current plan, it's covered in full. Pre and postpartum visits are covered in full. Delivery of the child is an inpatient hospitalization is covered in full. Under the site of service plan, your pre and postpartum visits are also covered in full. No copayment for those. However, the inpatient stay for delivery of the child is subject to that $1,000 deductible. Okay. So going on to the back, you guys still with me? I know health insurance, it can be fun, right?
Well, here's a question. When is this outpatient MRI and CT scans and all that?
Mm-hmm.
Does that have to be done? Is there a difference if it's done in the hospital or if you go to these other places that do that, just that?
Nope. For the high-end radiology, regardless of where you go, those are subject to the deductible. And I'm going to go back to outpatient surgery in just a minute.
Okay.
So regardless of where you go for that MRI, it doesn't matter. It is going to be subject to your deductible. Okay. But very quickly on the back, just to highlight a couple other items that are subject to the deductible, if you utilize the emergency room, you pay your copayment to walk through the door. And then depending on what services you receive while you're in the ER, those are subject to that $1,000 deductible. Okay. So not everything that they do, but some of the services. Ambulance rides, those are subject to their deductible.
Okay. Subject to the
$1,000 deductible. Yeah. So again, if you've met your deductible by having other services in the year, that ambulance ride would be covered in full for you.
Can I just tell a quick story?
Sure.
Someone in my family took an ambulance ride.
Quick.
Someone took an ambulance ride. I got a bill for like, because I'm the guy that provides you, I got a bill for like $660. Mm-hmm. It was like, the ride was like a mile.
Mm-hmm.
So like, I thought I had this great insurance, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So like, my wife was like, I'll just pay it because, you know, they, you know, just, you know, we should just pay it. And I'm like, I'm calling somebody. So I called and the girl was like, yeah, you don't have to pay that. We'll pay it, but we only pay it in installments. So when they send you another bill, then you contact us again and then we'll pay it. But we won't pay it. So like, in other words, they paid an initial payment of like $600.
Mm-hmm.
Looked like it was leaving me on the hook for $600.
Mm-hmm.
But then when I called them, they said, oh, no, no, we'll pay that, but we make them send two bills. I'm like, okay.
Meanwhile, so you're responsible for the interest.
But had you not called.
But had I not called, I guess the reason I'm just telling that is so people will hear that, had I not called,
right.
It was going to be between me and the fire department.
And I always recommend anytime you get a bill, especially on your current plan, the Access Blue plan,
yeah,
all you're paying out of your pocket is, if you have durable medical equipment, it's the co-insurance. But otherwise, all you're paying is your co-payments. So everything else should be covered in full minus your co-payments.
Mm-hmm.
So if you get any bill that's more than $20, I would honestly call and ask why you're getting that bill.
Mm-hmm.
And who you can talk to is our Enrollee Services call center. Again, the number on the front of your folders. They're open 8:30 to 4:30, Monday to Friday. They can answer any questions that you have about anything that I go over today. Okay. They also have access to the claim system and to talk to Anthem. So it's much nicer than going through the Anthem call tree where you're hitting a gazillion buttons to get to a person or hitting zero over and over. The average answer time on our Enrollee Services center call center is 12 seconds. So you're going to get somebody to answer the phone.
Okay, it's much nicer than having to call Anthem directly.
So we all just took PT tests
mm-hmm.
for the PD, so we had to have a physical.
Mm-hmm.
So we all go to the doctors, get our physical, but they made us pay our copay.
Mm-hmm.
According to this, wouldn't that fall under the preventive care, so we shouldn't have paid anything?
That depends.
It says routine physical.
The reason I say it depends is because if it's a requirement for your job, they're going to code it differently.
Okay.
My doctor calls it like a form physical. So when I go for a PT test and I get the form physical, I get billed differently than if
right.
I go for like my own annual physical.
Right. Exactly. Because there's different things that... My understanding of it is that there's different procedures and services that they provide in a physical for just yourself, you know, the layman, and what you would do for your job. So that potentially could be why there's a difference in the copay there. Okay. So very quickly, I just want to touch on some differences between these plans, and then we'll take a little bit, look at this calculator a little bit. So for physical, occupational, and speech therapy, there is a big difference between these two plans. On your current plan, you get up to 60 visits combined for all three of those therapies. So you could technically use all 60 of them for therapy, for physical therapy, and then you wouldn't have any others for the other two therapies. You could use 20 of each, 40 of one, 20 of another. Doesn't matter, any combination to get you to 60. Under the site of service plan, you get up to 20 per therapy. Okay, so that's a strict 20 per therapy.
And then you don't pay a copay for that?
After that, if you have, say, the 21st visit, you would be responsible for the full cost of that visit.
Right, but for the first 20, every
yes.
time you go, you pay a copay?
Correct.
Of
and under
20?
The site of service, it would be $40 for those therapies. Yep.
Wow.
Chiropractic care, there's no difference between the two plans. The only thing, in terms of visit limits, you get 12 on either one. Under the Access Blue 20, it would be a $20 copayment. Under site of service, it would be a $40 copayment. The last thing I like to highlight is just the behavioral health care. This is outpatient and inpatient behavioral health care, so that's your mental health and substance abuse treatment. For the current plan, you pay your copayment, so again, it's $20 under your current plan. Under the site of service, depending on which type of doctor you're going to, they can bill, it's a little sketchy area, they can bill as a PCP or as a specialist, so I always recommend that if anybody on your plan is utilizing these services, talk to those doctors and say, do you bill as a PCP or as a specialist, so that you'll know whether it's going to be a $20 or $40 copay. Okay, but for outpatient visits, so just visiting those doctor offices, it's unlimited visits on either plan. Okay, one of the good things that came out of the Affordable Care Act, unlimited visits for those. Inpatient care, so whether you are partially or fully hospitalized for these treatments, under your current plan, they're covered in full. Under the site of service, they're subject to that $1,000 deductible.
All right, can you repeat what you just said?
Sure. So whether you are partially or fully hospitalized for behavioral health care, mental health, or substance abuse treatment, under your current plan, it's covered in full. Under the site of service, it would be up to that $1,000 deductible. And the prescription drug plan that this would be paired with, they're identical. There's no difference between your current prescription plan copayments and the prescription plan that would be paired and is paired with the site of service plan. So I had you guys, I'm sorry, bring you back to where you starred that item on the front. Okay, so we're talking outpatient surgery and lab tests. So I know if a few of you might be on this plan, but the site of service plan introduces consumerism into the medical plan, where if you choose to be a savvy medical consumer and seek these two services at certain locations, you're going to benefit by those items not hitting your deductible. Okay, so inside of your folder, there are two sheets. I'm going to have you pull them out, the last two that are on the right. Okay. The first is for lab tests. So this flyer with the state of New Hampshire right on the front. So the average markup to have your labs done at a hospital location is 300%. So HealthTrust is a nonprofit organization, so over 90% of what we charge to the town for your premiums is based strictly on claims. So if we're able to bring down the claims costs, hopefully that is able to mitigate any future premium increases for you guys. So lab costs, because there can be such a difference there, these were introduced into the site of service plan. So
So if you chose to use one of these locations for the site of service lab, so to get any of your blood drawn, or this also counts for like a urine analysis. Okay, so if you get your labs done at any one of these locations, and you'll notice that there are different websites under each of these. So if you were to go to the website for Concord Hospital Independent Outpatient Laboratory, that would show you the Pennacook Family Physicians Lab. They have one in Pembroke, one in Epsom, the Horseshoe Pond Lab, so right off there off 93. That's a site of service lab location. So there's other locations that are listed under here. I did take a look at the Lakes Region General Hospital one, so you can take a look at what labs are in that vicinity as well. So you'll notice there's one on Highland Street in Laconia, the Inner Lakes Clinical Lab in Meredith, the Laconia Clinic Laboratory, Franklin Regional Hospital, Newfound Clinic in Bristol. So they're all over the place, but there's more labs if you go to these websites. If you choose a site of service location for your labs, you won't pay anything. It's covered in full by the site of service plan. Okay, no copay, nothing. If you instead choose to go to somewhere off of this list, let's just say Dartmouth-Hitchcock, and have your lab done at Dartmouth-Hitchcock, you could pay up to your $1,000 deductible for those labs. So it's your choice as the consumer there if you want to use a site of service location or not. Okay. Same thing applies for outpatient surgeries. That's this listing here. So this is a listing of ambulatory surgical centers. Okay. So it's about 4 pages long. Outpatient surgeries, these are your day surgeries. So let's say an ACL reconstruction on your knee, a shoulder surgery, carpal tunnel, things like that. If you were to need an outpatient surgery, if you choose to have the surgery done at any one of these locations here, and you'll notice that, for example, Franklin Regional Hospital, there's an X on every single one because they provide that surgery for every single type of procedure that you might need. Okay, so the X means that's good. They offer it there. So if you choose to have your outpatient surgery done at any of these locations, you'll pay a $75 copay under the site of service plan. If you instead choose to go somewhere else that's not on this list to have that surgery done, it could go up to your $1,000 deductible. Okay, so again, it's a choice for you. I always remind folks that it's not about the surgeon that's doing the surgery, it's about the location that the surgery is happening in. So for example, Concord Orthopedics. I know a lot of people in this area utilize Concord Orthopedics. Mm-hmm. Concord Orthopedics, their legal name is Capital Orthopedic Surgery Center, LLC. So their ambulatory surgical center right inside of their building is on this list. So if you had your surgery done in their building, you'd pay a $75 copay. But instead, if you chose to have that surgery done up the hill at Concord Hospital, you could pay up to your $1,000 deductible because it's not a site of service location. Okay. But that surgeon can most likely do the surgery in either location. So it's talking to your surgeon and saying, hey, I have this plan. If I have it done at any of these locations, I'm going to pay a $75 copay. Do you have privileges to do the surgery at any of these locations?
They should know that, though, right?
They should know
that. Not necessarily, because they're not doing it. If you have a total knee replacement, they're only doing it at Concord Hospital now. They will not do it at the Concord Orthopedic Facility.
Right, but they'll know that.
Right.
So they won't say,
so,
oh,
right.
Yeah,
but if you're having finger surgery,
right.
They'll do it at the Concord Orthopedic Facility.
And a total knee replacement can be a little different, too, because that's a more invasive surgery that might not be deemed outpatient at that point.
And I've learned, too, because we've had to access a lot of medical care up at Dartmouth, is I have to tell them, because they want to schedule you for all these things. And I say, no. I said, I'll schedule it through mine. Because if you let them go ahead and schedule it, they'll just schedule it right at Dartmouth, and it's not covered.
Mm-hmm.
And the same services you can get for an MRI, it's like...
And to clarify, it's covered. You can go anywhere in the network that you want to go to.
Cost more.
It just costs more, correct. So remember, those two flyers that I had you look at, that's only applicable to those two services. So labs and outpatient surgery. If you need an X-ray, regardless of where you have it, is going to be subject to that deductible. Okay, so just keep that in mind, just those two services.
$75
at the ambulatory surgical center for that surgery. Yes.
No, the X-rays. The X-rays is for. Goes towards $1,000.
Yes, the X-rays would go toward the deductible. Okay. So
very quickly before we go to our calculator.
If the surgery would only be $75?
It'd be a $75 copay.
Oh, $75 copay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Quick little question. If you have a Massachusetts PCP that you pay extra for, is there like a little list like this that has these types of facilities in Mass?
For the site of service location, the ambulatory surgical centers are just what's on that list.
Okay.
But for labs, labs do go out into the surrounding states.
Okay.
So like any Quest lab location, LabCorp, Nordex, any of those national labs are going to be part of the site of service location.
Okay.
So I know that there's some Quest, for example, that are right over the border and in
mm-hmm.
Boston area. So you'd have access to those too.
And there's one in Guilford.
Yes, there is a Quest location in Guilford as well. There's two in Concord, one in Guilford, and then several in the southern tier as well. Okay. So is anybody familiar with flexible spending accounts?
We're going to learn about it right now.
Yes. I hope you're not sick of hearing me already. So flexible spending accounts, these are owned by you. Okay. So the flexible spending account is something that we administer at Health Trust. It allows you to put money away pre-tax through payroll deduction into an account that HealthTrust administers for you. You can use that account for any health care related expense. So anything from copays to deductibles to things that may not be covered by your plan. So let's say acupuncture. Acupuncture is something that you can use your FSA for, okay, your flexible spending account for. You can use it for glasses, contacts, braces, any type of dental procedures that you may have, with the exception of tooth whitening. You can't do it for tooth whitening. But say your kid needs braces, you can put money away pre-tax into this account to pay for that. Okay. The IRS does have a listing on their website. It's thousands and thousands and thousands of items that are eligible for the FSA. Okay. So what it does is the healthcare FSA, you choose at the beginning of the year the amount that you'd like to set aside pre-tax. So we always tell folks to be conservative in the amount that you're going to set aside. If you know, like Joyce said, that you're on three maintenance medications and they're going to cost you $10 every 3 months, then you know that you're going to spend that exact amount of money. You can set that aside and know for sure that you're going to be utilizing that. Okay, if you know that you have to get some glasses in the year, what they're going to cost, you can put that money away pre-tax. Okay, but you make your decision, or your election is what we call it, at the beginning of the year. So say you decide to put aside $2,000, okay? That money will be available to you on the first day of the plan year. So you have the flexible spending account. You have two ways you can access the account. Either you can submit reimbursement and get a paper check back from Health Trust, or we have what's called a Benny card as well. So with the Benny card, it's basically just like a debit card that's linked to your FSA account. So if you go to your doctor's office and you've put $2,000 into that account, it's available on day one. You go to your doctor's office, you can swipe your Benny card for that $20 copayment. Okay, and it will automatically come out of your flexible spending account.
Which also goes towards your $1,000 deductible?
No.
Okay.
So your copayments don't go toward your deductible. So any of those three types of cost sharing, they don't go toward each other, but they all go toward that out-of-pocket limit.
Right.
Okay, does that make sense? Perfect. So let's say you know that you're going to need a pair of glasses and you don't want to have to scramble to get that money right at the same time that you know that you're going to need them. Let's say they're a $500 pair of glasses. That's not so far off. I paid about $450 for my last pair. The beginning of the year, you can go into that doctor's office, say, yep, I need my glasses, swipe your Benny card, and pay for those glasses. Okay. So how the money works is that, as I mentioned, it's available to you on day one of the plan year, so that full $2,000, let's say. But it'll come out of your paycheck in equal installments throughout the year. Okay, so I don't know how many pay periods you have or anything like that, but it would break down into equal installments throughout the year. So let's say it's 52 pay periods, take your $2,000, divide it by 52. That's how much is going to come out of your paycheck every single year to fund, or every single week.
So it's like an extended loan system, is all it is.
Correct.
You're paying back through the year.
Correct. It's like a loan to yourself.
Pre-tax, yeah.
That you're not paying taxes on.
Pre-tax and interest fee.
Yes. Pre-tax and interest fee.
Now, if there's any money left over in that account, what happens to it?
So if there's any money left over in the account, traditionally this is a use it or lose it account. So you have to utilize all the funds by the end of the year, so it would be forfeited. However,
who would take it?
It goes back to the town.
Goes back to the town?
Yes.
Wouldn't they just tax it and then cut you a check?
that's up to the town.
They're prohibited by the IRS from doing that.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So what happens if money's forfeited from a FSA, the employer first can use any of it to offset their expenses, so they're paying a fee to health trust to offer the plan and their time processing enrollment forms. And then anything that's remaining has to be divided equally among everyone who participated in the FSA, and they each get an equal increment. Because the IRS says they can't give it back to the employee because you got it tax-free.
Right,
so
okay.
That's how they handle, that's the regulations on it.
However.
Thank you. And
however,
the town does have options, though. So the town, the IRS did introduce two options for the town where they could do either a 2.5 month grace period. So it gives you as the enrollee 2.5 additional months after the end of the year to incur and ask for reimbursement for eligible expenses. Or they can do what's called a $500 carryover, which allows you to carry over up to $500 into the next plan year. Okay, so the town can elect one of those options or not do that at all and keep it a traditional use it or lose it account.
But at the end, also, aren't there little things that you can purchase for your under your flexible medical?
Yes.
That you can, you know, if you've got $100 left over that you know that you're going to spend money on
yes.
medical.
So things like, we do
medicinal
have people who
things.
Go out
sunglasses.
And buy, they'll buy like sunblock, over 30 SPF sunblock. You can
right.
buy that. First aid kits, Band-Aids. Rash ointment for infants. You can buy things like that under the FSA program as well. So what a great benefit of having the Benny card that we pair it with is so if you go to any, let's just say Target, and you go to Target and you walk in and you buy 12 different items, okay, you may not know which one's FSA eligible and which one's not. So let's say you buy a bag of chips, a candy bar, a first aid kit, and some sunblock. You go to the register. You can go to the register and then you swipe your Benny card. It'll pay for your sunblock and your first aid kit, and it'll ask you for a different tender for your chips and your candy bar. Okay, so that'll automatically know.
Well,
so it's nice to
know
those.
That?
It's the way it's coded in their system. So there's a specific coding that almost every large retailer has. So
yeah.
Same thing would happen if you went to CVS or any of the Rite Aids, things like that.
Yeah.
It's automatically coded in their system what's FSA eligible and what's not FSA eligible. So,
so
I always say go in and swipe that Benny card first. It'll take everything that's FSA eligible.
I've noticed like at Walgreens, I don't know if CVS does it or not, at the end of your slip it will tell you
mm-hmm.
how much you have eligible or can spend.
Right.
The,
it'll say
eligible
health
for
item.
FSA. Yeah.
Yeah.
But we don't have an FSA account.
Right. So that's something to keep in mind. That would be paired with. So you pay, if you have any funds that would come through an HRA, whatever would not be covered by the HRA could be covered by the FSA in terms of the deductible. The FSA can then be used for any of your co-payments or any other health related eligible items that you would pay throughout the year. Okay.
And that, so that resets on the calendar year just like the HRA resets on the calendar year.
Correct.
Okay.
So if you were to implement that in July, we would do what's called a short plan year. For you. So let's say the town elects a maximum of $2,000, you'd have $1,000 available to you in this plan year, and then that would reset for January where you would have access to the full $2,000 for the next year. Okay. So something to keep in mind. Are you ready to go through some examples?
Yeah, and then at some point you're going to do the site of service, where you go online and get prices for mammograms and colonoscopies.
Yes.
And
yes, that's part of the slice of life program.
Okay.
So what I've done is I've created what I call a cost calculator, which will sort of give you an idea of what your cost would be under your current plan as compared to site of service plan. Okay. So I mentioned several items that are subject to the deductible under the site of service plan where there's not a deductible on your current plan. So I was only able to include one item that's subject to the deductible in this calculator, but you can always put a 1 or a 2 in that area if you know that one or more people are going to have items subject to the deductible. Okay. So the item that's subject to the deductible under this one is right here, the inpatient surgery. If you know that you're going to need an MRI or x-rays in the coming year, or it's likely that, say, someone in your family is they are an inpatient many times,
then you can go ahead and put a one here, and that'll give you the worst case scenario for your deductible. Okay. So I'm gonna go ahead and do it. The majority of the folks in the room, are they single, two-person, or family plans? What would you like to What would you like to start with?
About family.
Okay. So this is the family calculator that we're actually in here. So right on the top, it's gonna show you the annual cost for a family plan right now under your current plan is $27,810. Under the site of service plan, the annual premium is $22,417. Currently, you pay 16.5% of that as the enrollee. So this is your total out-of-pocket cost just for your premium for the year, $4,588. Under the site of service plan, it shows you that that would be zero. So as we go down, let's say we're on a family plan, and we have, go ahead and throw out some numbers. How many preventive care visits do you think your family would have? How many members of your family? Four? Sure, let's do that. How many PCP office visits do you think your family might do in a year?
Ten.
Okay. So we'll enter that in. Specialist office, so these are like neurologists. Rheumatologists, cardiologists, want to say two, three? Oh,
would that include like orthopedists?
Yes.
Okay, orthopedists.
And you said chiropractor too, right? It falls under that?
Chiropractor is down toward the bottom. We're going to do that one separately.
All right.
Yeah, so specialist office visit, five, six?
Seven.
Let's do seven. ER visits. This is for your copay. I don't know if I want to be in your family.
Depends if you're a skier.
Three.
Well, would you go to the hospital or would you go to urgent care? Because isn't it cheaper to go to urgent care?
Yeah, by $50, but they're only open till 8.
Yeah, don't have any emergencies any other time.
It also depends on how long the wait is. All right.
So let's say two for your family. Let's say you go to the ER twice in a year. A piece of durable medical equipment, let's just say, worst case scenario, if you had to have a piece of durable medical equipment, it was $1,000. I just want you to see what it would cost under either plan, so I'll put one there. Outpatient surgery performed at an ambulatory surgical center. So this is assuming that you're using one of those site of service locations. Let's just say one of your family members needs that. Let's say, worst case scenario, three or more people hit their full deductible under the family plan. So we'll do three there. Laboratory tests performed at a site of service location. Again, this is the preferred location. Let's say you guys get them done 12 times.
Yeah.
Good idea. Chiropractic visits. Everyone on the plan can have up to 12 visits per year. How many would you like to put in?
24.
Physical therapy visits.
Six.
Okay. So what this has done, now toward the bottom, you want to talk prescriptions? 15. Let's talk prescriptions. Let's say
go there with me.
They're going to be the same under either plan, so let's do 5.
Yeah, they'll all be the same.
5. Let's just say you get 5 of everything. I know, you're on a lot. Your family's on a lot, let's just say. Okay. So what this has done is it has calculated out for you, on the bottom here, your total out-of-pocket costs. So for your medical costs under your current plan, oops, I just knocked something over, it'd be $1,340 just for your medical, so the visits to your doctor, your ER visit, your inpatient hospitalization, your outpatient surgery. It'd be $5,235 under the site of service plan. Okay. Here's your cost of your prescriptions under either plan is identical because there's no change to the prescription plan. This number here factors in what you've paid for premiums and what your medical and prescription costs are. So you're going to notice under your current plan, you'd pay a total of $6,903 between premium and all of your out-of-pocket costs. Under the site of service plan, you'd pay $6,210. And that was assuming that three or more people hit their full $1,000 deductible. As Wendy said earlier, I think the percentage she used was about 20% of people actually hit their deductible. So this is your worst case scenario, that if three or more people on your family plan hit that deductible.
Well, plus you deduct $750 from that.
Correct. If you're getting an HRA and you're getting 25% of the deductible, you could subtract $750 from that $6,200 number.
Times three, right?
No, that's the full. You're getting 25% of the full.
3,000.
Yeah, 25%.
25%, 3,000.
Yes. Yes.
Sure. 750.
So that's where you get that number there.
But the 5,235 is upfront out-of-pocket expense, correct?
Well, that would be your copay
for the site
versus
service?
Co-insure.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yep. But,
okay. Yeah,
that,
no, but
that's a could be though. That's only a could be.
So let's say let's
you're
do
looking
another.
You're
just a
worst case scenario here.
I know, but you could put that on. You could put that on your little flex card.
Yeah,
that
I'm
you
not
don't want to
flex
use.
Card.
So,
all right. Well,
so that's
coming out
of your
pocket and a half. Well, if I ever heard it.
750.
Not if you're going to use it.
750. Yeah.
But you lose
paid.
It at the end of the year if you don't use it.
Very few people forfeit funds. It, most people know to plan
towards
that,
the end of the year.
Yeah,
you
they plan what,
in,
yeah,
toothpaste and all that.
It's expected expenses. Not you don't put it in and then say I'll figure out later what I might have for expenses. You go through what
you
spent. Yeah,
and that's a choice. So
yeah.
That as for you as a consumer, that's why the town is giving you choices as to what you can choose, what's best for you. So this just gives you an example of if you had that worst case deductible expense, this is what it would look like for that year in your premiums and your out of pocket costs. So let's say, let's do another one, just a little different. So let's say it's a more
realistic one.
More of a realistic one. So let's say you have, we'll keep the 4 preventive visits. We'll keep the PCP office visits at 10. Let's say you have 5 members of your family and everybody goes twice. That's a realistic example. Specialist visits, usually these are around 3 or 4. ER visits, let's say just one person goes. Okay. Most people do not have that durable medical equipment cost, okay? And if they do, it's usually much, much lower than that. So let's say a pair of crutches is $100, okay? So that number is going to be far lower than this $1,000 that I gave you, this big example, okay? Outpatient surgery, that could happen here. Usually on a family, you may only have one person that hits anything subject to their deductible, okay? Let's just say it's one person. Right, and they hit their full $1,000 deductible. Laboratory tests, we can still keep that at 12 or maybe 8. Let's do 8. Chiropractic visits, that could stay at 24. If you have 2 people who use all 12, or do you want to do like 12, anything lower? Do you want to keep it at 24?
Zero.
We can do that too. Physical therapy visits, let's say we'll keep it at 6 because that's realistic, especially if you had somebody that did an outpatient surgery in this example. Okay. So here's where your numbers play out now. So for this family plan, remember we're talking a family plan. Under your medical care, you're looking at $480 under your current plan out of pocket. The site of service plan is at $1,735. Okay. We haven't even talked about your prescriptions yet, so let's go and make these 3s. And again, do the majority of people utilize generics?
Mm-hmm.
Most people do. Over 85% of everybody utilizes a generic. So why don't we make this, let's say you have 3 people, each on 2 prescriptions each. Usually we'll do retail preferred medication. Let's do that one. Usually the non-preferred, we have very few. Less than 8% of all the prescriptions filled by all of Health Trust members are those non-preferred brand name medications. Okay, so a little more realistic here. Let's say you're on 1 mail order, 1 preferred, and just for poops and giggles, let's put 1 non-preferred. So again, your out-of-pocket costs for your prescriptions are the same on either one. And here's your total out-of-pocket for both of these plans. So a little bit more of a realistic example of what you might hit. Under your current Access Blue plan, you'd pay in premiums and your out-of-pocket costs $5,273.77. Under the site of service plan, $1,940 in your premium and out-of-pocket costs. So it's taking a look at how your family utilizes the plan, how you utilize the plan on a normal year. Okay, we talked about our absolute, it was a horrible year for your whole family. That was our last example. Okay, this is a more of a realistic year. What do you utilize for prescriptions? What do you utilize the plan for? Do you feel more comfortable in paying more out of your paycheck and having no out-of-pocket expense for deductible? Or do you feel more comfortable in saying, okay, I think I can put that money away, or I feel okay with noting that I'm gonna have an HRA,
or that I'm gonna have an FSA that I can put money away pre-tax through all of my pay, my payroll, and I'm okay with, if I hit a little bit of that deductible, I'm okay with utilizing those two services to pay for those. Okay, so this tool, I have one for each of, I have one for each situation, so family, two person, and a single plan. So I'm gonna give this to Joyce so that she can give out to you, so you can take it, play with it, put numbers into it. You're not gonna mess it up. I have it blocked, so all you can fill in is the yellow. Okay, so don't worry about that. You can play with it yourself to say, this is what I think I would pay.
Okay. If I could just add, one of the things that you can do, you can go to the, there's a tremendous amount of information that you can have access to on the Health Trust website. And I mean, I'm in there every day. It's like up on my
yes.
my computer every day. But you can link to Anthem and log in, become a member of their website. You can go in and they will give you a printout for the year, whatever period you ask for. But I do it every year to calculate, geez, in 2014 I spent this, and it lays it all out for you. You don't have to be going through receipts to figure out, geez, what did I pay? So it'll give you, if you look at a couple years, it'll give you an idea of what you are really paying. And what services you're accessing in the year. It's a helpful tool.
So take a look at it, play with the calculator a little bit, because it could, depending on how you utilize your plan on a normal year or an average year, it could be saving you a lot of money out of your pocket. But again, it's your peace of mind. What are you most comfortable with as well? Okay. So I always say it's very personal. Healthcare is very personal. You know, the last thing you want to worry about when somebody gets sick is what your plan is going to cover. So understanding how the plan works and what options you have available to you is very personal to each person. So depends on your situation. If you have questions about specific procedures, so say you had something done this year that you absolutely know you're going to need next year, you can call Enrollee Services and they can tell you exactly how it would be covered under the site of service plan. Okay, so know that that's available to you as well, especially if you don't want to ask me, if you don't want anybody ever hearing you, what you had, or, you know, those types of things, it's okay. You can call that Enrollee Services Call Center as well. Okay.
Yeah, so that fungal infection you had in that girl.
All right. So as Joyce said, our website is healthtrustnh.org. You have access to several different services through our website. We are working to get Anthem onto our single sign-on as well right now. So as Joyce said, right now you go to anthem.com and you can log in using your user ID. So that one's separate right now. We hope in the spring everything will be through this one login. So let's say our secure login here. Has anybody utilized this yet? Mm-hmm. Anybody done their health assessment yet?
Don't trust it.
Then you've gone in here, Chief's like, yep, good. So you've gone through here. So let's say I'll just use mine, just so I can log you in so you can see what you have access to. Okay. So when you log in, you're going to see that there's a bunch of tiles on the right-hand side, and I'm going to do the super fast version of the wellness program and what you have access to here. I'm going to show you Smart Shopper, too. Has anybody utilized Smart Shopper? Just Joyce. Okay. So for things like MRIs that are going to be subject to your deductible if you switch to the site of service plan, you can actually search and see how much an MRI costs within a 20-mile radius of your home. So if you know that you're going to have an MRI and you're like, I'm going to pay the least amount of money possible out of my pocket for that MRI, you can actually see where to get it the cheapest in the area. Because it's the same machine, the same credentials for the radiologist that's going to do it. You can see that.
You guys sent out a flyer a while ago that had all that service listed with prices, stuff like that.
Does that, and is that where you get your check back from, Joyce?
Mm-hmm.
Because you checked that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. So you have access to your CVS Caremark here, so all of your prescriptions, if you're utilizing the mail order and all that, once you have a login through healthtrustnh.org, you have access to one click getting right into your prescription information. Anthem, we hope, again, will be up on this screen too very soon. The Smart Shoppers, the program I was just talking about, we'll click in there in a second. OnLife is your entire wellness program. So in the left-hand side of your packet is the 2017 wellness program. If you do your health assessment, which is just about 20 minutes to do, it It's a health questionnaire. Health Trust doesn't get any of that information. Anthem doesn't get any of that information. Neither does your employer. The only one who has access to that information is you, as well as a health coach, if you choose to work with them. It's basically just telling on yourself what you're doing great in regards to your health, what maybe you can work on. If you do that, you get a $50 check back in the mail. Okay. From there, you have access to the rest of the entire Slice of Life program. So I'll just click in here really quick so you can see what it looks like. If it'll go. But from here, you have access to earn up to $475 per year. Okay, as I mentioned, if you do your health assessment, you get a $50 check. If you do your biometrics, has anybody taken part in the biometrics?
I did once.
Good.
You're still running off that 50-year-old chart?
I don't.
Well, let me tell you what happened.
The BMI chart, yes. I know we all love that BMI chart. It's still what's out there.
Do I look obese?
Well, they tell me I'm overweight, too.
Well, that's the problem. So until they update that chart, I'm not going to do that system because they were terming me as obese. I got into an argument with the so-called coach and said, hey, how is it you guys can make these assessments accurately based upon a 60-year-old chart?
And that's what's used nationwide right now.
And that's
so
the problem.
I understand. But it's a choice. You don't want to do it, you don't know how to do it. That's why we make everything a choice.
But they won't listen to feedback either.
Who cares? Just do it, it's money.
No, because then they put you in a certain category. And they claim they're not going to use it against you, but I can tell you right now they will.
You're fat on.
We do not. There is a New Hampshire law that prohibits us from getting any information about this. So
just
we
like,
don't have any access.
Just like
to
this is a secure website, right?
It is a secure.
That's been hacked into, and now we have to have credit monitoring.
On that, let's just get you out of here on time. So we're gonna move on. Are you ready? Okay. It's okay. I grew up with two brothers. Okay. So inside here, you're gonna notice you have access to a whole bunch of different things. Up in the menu in the upper left-hand corner. If you want to work with a health coach, you don't have to if you don't want to, but if you want to, you can. This year we are offering a $50 cash incentive if you work with a health coach. So that's a new incentive for 2017. Okay. You also have the ability to do some trackers if you want to track your physical activity, track your eating, say you're working on stress management. There are programs through here where you can do a self-taught course. If you go through the course, you earn what we call points. For every quarter this year, if you earn 250 points, you're going to get a $50 check in the mail. Okay. So if you have things like Fitbits, if you have a Fitbit on your wrist and you link it to here, it'll automatically track your points for you. So for every 50,000 steps that you take, you're going to earn 25 points. So again, if you get the 250 points in the corner, you'll get a $50 check. So in total, you can earn up to $200 a year in tracking your physical activity or tracking other items through the web portal.
Bet you wish you didn't sell that sucker on Craigslist.
Did you buy it after January 1st?
Does it matter?
It does.
Because you could get money back.
If you bought it after January 1st and you have your receipt, you can send that in. You can get up to $100 reimbursement for the purchase of a Fitbit this year. That's a new reimbursement.
Then I'm going to go buy another one.
So you've got a link
yeah,
into the portal.
Yeah,
show
me
okay. So I can go buy another one and get reimbursed for it?
As long as you link it to the portal.
How much are they?
About 120 bucks.
Yeah, depends on what you buy.
I'm doing it.
It can go anywhere from $40 up to, if you do an Apple Watch, it could be like $500. It depends on what you're going to get. But you can get reimbursed up to $100 a year.
And any Fitbit can be linked to your website?
Yes. There are lots of different devices and apps that you can link, so you don't necessarily have to have a Fitbit. You can have a Jawbone. You can have a, what are all the other ones?
Do you get reimbursed for those too, though, or is it just Fitbit?
It's any device.
If
that
I
you
go
can
buy
link.
One, I can. Okay.
Yep. So they have.
She's already shopping.
They have Garmin. They have
Amazon
Jawbone.
Prime.
They have. You can link apps as well. So like a Map My Run or Map My Ride or anything like that. You can also link those to the account, and they can track
sell
for you.
Offer up.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
What else did we miss here? The other thing is, so you can get the up to $100 for the fitness tracker, or you can get reimbursed for classes that you either take online or in person. So say you went to a yoga class and you paid $10 for the class, you can fill out a form, send it into Health Trust, we'll send you a check back for taking that course. It's just engaging in health and wellness related activities. So you can take part in the whole entire program, earn up to $475. Your spouse on the plan can also earn up to $475 in the year. Any dependents, they can get reimbursed up to $200 through the program. So if they're taking, you know, ballet classes, gymnastics, you have your little boy in karate, they do a soccer camp that's instructional, that's $100. You can get reimbursed for that. Okay, so there's a full list of that on our website, but lots and lots of incentives that you can earn through the program. Again, all voluntary. You can choose whether or not you want to do it. Okay. One other program that is voluntary as well that I'm just going to touch on is right here, Smart Shopper. Really quick, I know Joyce wanted me to touch on this. Smart Shopper.
Instant checks.
Yeah. So Smart Shopper is a program that you can search for certain procedures. Okay, and what, do what we call shop for them. So inside of your folder here is information about which procedures you can shop for and how to log in. Okay, so you saw how quickly I got to this page here. So you can find out information about Smart Shopper. I will tell you that any of your searches that you do through here, we do not have access to those. Okay, Smart Shopper is the only one who has access to those. The only thing that HealthTrust gets is aggregate data. So aggregate data we can't even get for your group or small groups under 100. So for you guys, you're in what we call the 50 and under pool. So all, any and all of HealthTrust member groups that are 50 and under are all pooled together. We get aggregate data for the whole pool. So how many people actually shopped, how many people are eligible, and what was the total savings, and what could the savings have been. That's the only information that we get. We don't get that John Smith from Tilton shop for an MRI and a colonoscopy. He didn't utilize the program. He didn't get any. We don't get any of that information. It's just aggregate data. Okay. So let's shop for a service from here. So all you do is click on shop on service, shop for service.
Yeah, do a colonoscopy.
You want to do a colonoscopy?
Not necessarily.
From here, because I'm logged in as me, if I did just a regular search from here, it's going to search from my home in Loudoun. But I want to see what you guys would see if you're searching from Tilton. So I'm going to click on Advanced Search. I'm searching as myself. If I wanted to search for my husband or for my daughter, I can do that because I'm the subscriber. So you would have the ability to do that
and
as
I
well.
I get my husband's checks.
See, I do it for my husband and he just automatically gets checks.
Yeah,
he doesn't know why.
Yeah,
I say that belongs to me.
Right.
So we're going to search from Tilton, and I think it was 03276?
Yep.
All right, so let's search from Tilton. We're going to do outpatient, I believe it's an outpatient diagnostic. You can just guess, and it'll pop it up. There we go. Colonoscopy, we're going to search for that. Do you have a provider in mind? You can say yes or no. This just tells us what, in terms of that aggregate data, it'll tell us whether or not this idea and showing you these different options made you change your mind or not. That's all it's going to tell us. It doesn't matter if you have a provider in mind or not. So I'm just going to say no. Agree to the search terms and conditions. You can read them if you'd like. Pretty standard. And we're going to click continue. So this is going to show me, I'll make it a little bigger for you, exactly from 20 minutes of the Tilton location, that if you were to need a colonoscopy, if you went to the Concord Endoscopy Center right at, that's the location at Horseshoe Pond, if you went there, you would get $150 cash incentive for having your colonoscopy done there. Not only is it free, preventive, under your plan, you would get $150 cash incentive. Notice the price for that procedure there, $1,400. The very next option, the price for that procedure is $1,700, so it's not as cost effective, so you wouldn't get an incentive for going there. For some searches, you'll get multiple different locations that may be deemed cost effective. So, for example, it could say $150, and then if Concord Hospital was cost effective for that procedure, it could say a $50 incentive. So you have a choice there.
Does that have the ability, if you put in a dollar amount, to give you the best hits, or is it just going to be a mileage radius?
It's going to be a mileage radius.
Just a mileage radius.
Correct. But say if you know that you get
all of your medical care in Concord. You can search from the Concord zip code, and it'll only search within that area. You can also expand your radius. So if you wanted to expand to get, you know, a different radius, you could do that. So let's go back and do another search from...
Was that for both plans?
Yes, this is applicable to any plan that you have through Health Trust. Correct. So let's do the same procedure, and we'll just do it from my house so you can see what it looks like and if it's a little different. So I just start typing colonoscopy. I'm going to agree to the search terms. This is searching from Loudoun, so the results might be different. But let's see what we get. So from Loudoun, might see my choices changed a little bit. So from a 20-mile radius around Loudoun, or what are we at, a 30-mile radius, excuse me, Concord Endoscopy Center is still the most cost-effective, so I would get a $150 check there. Look at the Hitchcock Clinic. That's now in my radius. Okay. Look the difference in the price, though. $2,300. So we're talking a big jump in what they charge for those procedures. I would get a $75 cash incentive, though, for going to the Hitchcock Clinic. Okay. So depending on what service that you're looking for, and the location that you're looking for it in, it may change the choices that you have in terms of cost-effective locations. Okay, this program is entirely separate from Slice of Life, so you can do this without having a login or taking part in the points or anything like that. This is entirely separate.
Were these kickbacks going on last year?
Yes.
It's too bad you didn't teach our class last year.
You might be able to retro it, though.
We did come in and do an education session, but I had very few people attend.
You got the
he wasn't
going to
attend today either, but his friend called him.
So, and I know that Joyce tries to push out as much information as she can, but it was available last year. Chief, did you have a question?
Just the cash incentive. So does that come off your
deductible?
Deductible?
No. So this is a check mailed directly to your home.
Oh, gotcha.
You could
okay.
use it to buy shoes, for vacation,
so
whatever you want to use it
it's like a bounty.
Schedule your colonoscopy next week. You can have a $150 check.
Let's say it's something subject to your deductible,
no
like an MRI.
Deductible.
If you get $150 cash incentive back, you can put that toward your cash incentive. Correct. You can utilize it for whatever you want. It's your check coming directly to you.
Do it on a day off.
She's already trying to cost me $75 in gas.
So it's a choice for you. Any questions about any, well, really anything that we went over today, or any questions for Wendy, too?
She'd like to know what your highest payout is. What?
It's $500, and it's for a Remicade infusion.
What is that?
For what?
Remicade infusion. It's an intravenous medication utilized for ulcerative colitis, I believe.
What's the second highest?
$250.
It's right on your list on the back.
She's already going.
She's adding up the amount of money.
Shoulder surgery, umbilical hernia, a laparoscopic tubal block or tubal ligation.
Ooh,
there you go.
Knee surgery.
What about a green laser surgery?
Well,
I've had that done.
I don't
so.
Know. But things that, you know, some of the most common that we see folks shop for are things that maybe your doctor's not providing, getting you into the type of program. Lab services is a good example. Okay. So with the site of service plan, I always recommend always make sure you're utilizing a site of service location first. Shop for it. If they match, fantastic. Not only will you get $0 copay for those labs and it's free, but you'll get a $25 cash incentive back. So like a Quest lab, I get both. It's fabulous.
So like this physical therapy?
Yes.
Shows up to $150 or $150 instead of. So she goes to PT once because her knee hurts.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to send her a $150 check?
This is what
yes.
I'm saying.
It's for, physical therapy is for the episode of care. So if your
sure.
doctor sends the PCP referral for 10 visits.
Do we
say.
Need a referral to do that?
Too bad Luke's not
technically,
here.
No, but normally a physical therapist will not take you
right.
without having a referral.
Well, we could send it
because
two.
There's got to be a reason you're going
unless
to that physical
you're
therapist.
Make sure
like
so you'll finish, say you finish those 10 visits, they'll send you the cash incentive for those 10 visits. And say
area.
2 months later you have to go again for, say, a shoulder. You would again get an incentive if you're utilizing
can't do
a cost-effective location.
you can't get a mammogram until like in your 40s. You can't just go
that's
get a mammogram.
Really?
Unless there's a
that's
specific
been changing
reason
like
for
every
it.
Year.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You would think
right.
one that checked a lot.
Okay.
They just don't care about
I don't see prostate exams on here. Where's the prostate
exam?
That's like a colonoscopy.
No. So this is the full listing of services that you can shop for right now. 2 years ago, we did add lab services and physical therapy, so it's possible that it could change. But as of right now, this is the full listing of the services. If it does change, you will get a direct mailer with the new list.
If you get a report, you're getting a $25.
Yes.
I apologize. I was in Superior Court, so I've got to catch up a little bit. Do physicals, is that something that's covered in the SOS, or is it?
Yes. Any routine care, like annual physicals, mammograms, colonoscopies, eye visits, things like that, are covered in full, not subject to the deductible. No copayment either.
Subject to the copay, though.
It's for your annual routine care. For the one that you guys have, your physicals that you have to take.
For our PT test, that we just did, that physical, you got to pay your copay. Because it's for your job, it's job related. It's not like your regular.
They actually do that now.
But not your deductible.
Right. In part two, so the deductible amount, so let's say a family is $3,000. So that could get pre-tax put away in savings account for payroll, right?
Yes. Through a flexible spending account, yes. You can put away money pre-tax for any health-related costs that you might have, health, dental, and vision.
Only
so,
if the town agrees to it, or that's no matter what.
Correct. The town would have to set the limit. So the IRS limit is $2,600 for 2017. The town can put it lower if they want to. So let's say it's $2,000. You could choose up to that maximum that the town sets. And then it comes out in equal installments through your paycheck throughout the remainder of the year.
Oh, you didn't mention dependent care, because we have quite a few officers that have small children.
Thank you. So dependent care FSA, thanks for mentioning that, Joyce. There is the healthcare FSA that we've talked a lot about. There is a dependent care FSA as well. This allows you to set aside up to $5,000 every year pre-tax for the cost of dependent care, so child care in like a daycare center. There are some adult daycare items too if you have a dependent.
If you have a dependent over the age 13 or older that is your tax dependent and is incapable of self-care or mental or physical disability and lives with you at least half the year. So you have an elderly parent that is your tax dependent that goes to adult daycare, or maybe you have a 17-year-old that has some sort of physical disability. They can't go home by themselves after school. They need to go into a care-type setting. That would be an eligible dependent as well.
Thank you. You can utilize the FSA account for that as well. Unlike the healthcare FSA, though, the healthcare FSA, all that money is available to you on day one. The dependent care, you can only utilize those funds as you accrue them into the account.
But it's an in and an out.
Correct.
It's like you pay the check, you mail the receipt, boom, they reimburse you right
and
away.
We do, you can either do a paper check or an automatic deposit into your bank account.
You don't pay taxes.
You pay no
taxes. But how does that affect your tax at the end of the year? Because you can
still get your, do they still have the alternate child care tax credit?
For most people, unless you're a very high earner, you come out better doing it through a dependent care account, but you should always talk to your tax professional for your particular situation. But for most people, the maximum is $5,000 is the federal maximum. Most people spend more than $5,000.
Yeah.
So anything above that, you can claim on your taxes.
Claim.
Yep.
It's a way to get all of your dependent care tax
If you do $5,000 and you're like, so it's your federal, state, and FICA taxes is what it's exempt from. You can save probably $1,300 in taxes by running it through a dependent care. So it helps out a lot with the cost of child care.
I'm all about not paying taxes right now.
I mean, it made it affordable for me to put my child in daycare. And I just want to say, because I talk about FSAs all day long, but the healthcare one, I mean, really think about the healthcare FSA because it's not just related to your medical plan.
Mm-hmm.
It's any dental and vision expenses.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of people that this is the only way they can afford to get a crown or a dental implant for missing teeth or broken teeth because you get that money up front and then it's coming out of your pay over the course of the year. So for a lot of people, that is the only way they've been able to afford to get.
And
yeah.
Orthodonture, for those of you who
yes,
have
right.
kids that are getting right that pills.
And so there's more information up here too, if you wanted to take a look for the FSA accounts. There's more information up here, and I do like to point out inside of the healthcare one, on the inside here of the front cover, if I can get it to open, is an account worksheet, so you can actually put in, okay, what, how many times you go to the doctor, what are your co-payments for that, do you have a deductible, vision or hearing care, and prescription co-payments, so you can sort of get an idea, and it helps you figure out how much you might want to set aside in the FSA. And through that, again, we recommend being conservative in the first year, try it out, see how you like it. We find that almost everybody actually increases the amount in the second year. We have very few who actually decrease the amount. But that's for you there if you want additional information.
Just one other thing, too. If you could go back to the home page on Health Trust. I mean, all of us are paying for this through our premiums. So you really need to think about, because, I mean, you're paying for this, so let's use it. Mm-hmm. The EAP one, can you access the EAP one up there?
Not through here.
Oh, you can't do it
the
through
employee
that
assistance
yet?
Program life resources is not available through this
it isn't website
portal yet.
Okay.
Nope, but there is information right on this
yeah.
pamphlet here about life resources up on the top where you have access to. That's your employee assistance program, pretty much anything that causes you stress.
Yes, and it's
they can help
wonderful
with it.
And they offer tons of workshops, so you can go on there, and if there's something that, a lot of it's online, but they will come out and do workshops.
Yeah.
And I've distributed this information repeatedly at our staff meetings, but no one's taking advantage of them. And, you know,
but what's nice,
there.
Too, is it is anonymous. So it's the same exact login
yeah.
and the same exact password for every HealthTrust member. So if you were to log in, we wouldn't know that you logged in. We wouldn't know what employer you're with or what you went to access. Mm-hmm. Nobody knows. It's all anonymous because it's all the same username and same password. Yes.
The two plans, the site of service plan was the total was $22,417.
Yes.
And I just didn't get the first. The other one was
$27,800.
Are you talking about the
total?
Oh, the total cost. Yes, you're right on the top there.
Total cost was
$22,417.
Yeah. This year.
Yes.
$27,810.
And these are yes, 2017 rates. So those will change for next January.
So that's 5% higher than last year.
5.3.
Correct. 5.3% higher than last year.
For both plans.
And if you get a Cadillac tax rich over the 27.5, then you got to pay a percentage. I'm sure you're up on that, though.
Right. So inside here, I know Joyce was alluding to it. You have access to your Smart Shopper. You can get some medical information, just how what type of programs we offer through Health Trust here. If you want specific information about your plan, you can go to anthem.com and log in there. Again, we hope to have that up here in the spring. Slice of life information, so that's your on life. Prescription is your CVS Caremark. And then you would also have access to your dental information here as well. So if you were to click this dental link, it would bring you automatically into the Delta Dental website. So you can look at your outline of benefits, look at information on your claims. You could print another ID card through there as well. So if you ever have any information that you need about Delta Dental, you can do that directly by using the HealthTrust website. So we're trying to make it much easier for you. One username and password to access all of your benefits available through HealthTrust. Okay.
So
well, thank you guys for your patience today. You got a lot today, a lot of information.
Yeah,
I got a question. So they already mailed me my new cards for this year.
And then,
so does that mean that
I'm
still on this plan?
Questions, but when